Hi, I'm the Reverend John Romig, senior pastor here at the Gender Road Christian Church, and I'm really glad that you could join us today. I encourage you to get out your Bible and follow along as you hear the Word. We have a lot to cover today, so let's get started, and I know that God will bless you as you hear today's message. So if you have your mobile device, your smartphone, now would be the time to get on Facebook and check in, so that helps our outreach this week. And there's a little header at the top of the order of service that talks about that, and we just saw a little bit of a video. If you are new here today, you can fill out a visitor card if you'd like and either give that to one of the greeters or drop it in the offering. And then we use this blue card here as a symbol of our online giving. So if you give electronically, like I do, you can drop that in the plate. Or you can also use this as a prayer request and can also put that in the offering plate as that goes around as well. You may have noticed in your bulletin, there's a little insert. You want to get that out, take a look at it. When you open it up, it looks like somebody's notes. And they are. So we had a cabinet meeting this week, and we were talking about stuff. And what you see on the front of it, you know, where there's yellow and everything, is are some of the major events that we do throughout the year and chances for, you know, people to volunteer and help out with that. And then Karen Richards, who's the current president of the CWM, or the Christian Women's Ministry, she had gone through there and highlighted the events from 2016 and then the monies that were raised that was used for mission and so forth. And as you can see, last year, just in a few of these events, they raised over $5,400 throughout the year. And I'm like, wow, that is really good, because it shows, you know, one of the things that we don't do a good job here in the church is really telling the story of all the different groups and their activities and the ministries and the impact that they're having on people's lives. Like when we collect the shoe boxes at Christmas time and the stocking stuffers and the kits that we send up to the Cleveland Christian Home throughout the year and so forth. And I thought, these would look really good. And Karen's like, oh no, that's just my, you know, chicken scratch on there. And I said, don't worry, I won't tell anybody it's yours. And so we have that here. And then on, you can see on the other side, I kind of made a copy out of the Christian Women's booklet, which lists the different monthly events and service projects that they're part of. So if you are a woman, you are welcome to join CWM, and you can be part of that. So I just wanted to put that in there, because it's sometimes we get so busy and we move on to the next project, we forget who we've helped and what's been done, and we give God praise and thanks that that was able to be done with your help. So today is XGen Sunday, where our youth get to stay and worship, and they help us in different ways throughout the order of service. But first, we're going to sing our opening hymn. So will you stand as you are able? Let's greet the Lord in prayer and song. God, as we rise to greet you, we know that you have already met us here. Your presence fills this room. We come together as a faith community, as individuals yet connected, as people of faith, learning to be one, brothers and sisters, within your inclusive love. And we give you thanks. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Happy are those who walk in God's way.
Blessed are those who observe God's commandments.
Faithful are those whose eyes are fixed on righteousness.
Joyful are those whose hearts are filled with praise.
Come, let us love the Lord our God.
We come to worship the one who leads us in the ways of life. Amen.
Bow your heads and pray with me. Creator and sustainer God, throughout history, you have gathered people around your world to instruct and inspire. We give thanks for those who have received your wisdom and have shaped diverse and fulfilled communities to follow in your way. Continue to open that vision to us, that we may become transformed by the renewing of your word in our hearts and minds, Enable us to grow in love and understand for each other. Create us, O God, clean hearts and minds. Let us join with you in your suffering and your triumph. We desire to be your children, and we claim these blessings in your name. Amen.
Our first scripture reading today comes from Deuteronomy. And in this passage, Moses is speaking to the Israelites. It's towards the end. And, you know, remember when Moses was first being called by God, what excuse did he give God? Excellent choir. Very good. So the answer was, I'm not a good speaker. Lord, don't send me. You know, maybe send my brother or send somebody else, not me. But here in these last few chapters of Deuteronomy, he's just talking and talking and talking and going over with the Israelites all the things that God has done for them. Because the Israelites, like us, go through their ups and downs, their periods of where they are faithful to the Lord. They turn away from the Lord. They're faithful to the Lord. They turn to idols. They get distracted. And they want to go back to what seemed like a better time. And so Moses is saying to them, you have a choice. You can either follow God and have a life, live, be within the blessings that God provides to you, or if you don't follow, then you're choosing a different path. And so we'll hear now these words, and then we'll talk a little bit more about them.
We are reading from Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 15 through 20. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord, your God, that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord, your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous. And the Lord, your God, will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter the possesses. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob.
Well, not necessarily you, Jacob, but, you know, Jacob, and then eventually all the Jacobs. Just a little, his name is Jacob, in case you don't know. So here we have where Moses is saying, you have a choice. You can choose. You can choose life to obey the commandments. And, you know, 2 weeks ago, we started talking about the Sermon on the Mount and beginning with the Beatitudes. And then Jesus is teaching the disciples and to those listening that Jesus says, I've come not to abolish the law, but to uphold the law. Not one single letter, not one stroke of the law will disappear. And so we go back to the law, trying to understand what is the law, what are the commandments and these ordinances and decrees in which Jesus teaches from. Now, remember that the commandments come, or the law comes after God has already claimed the people of Israel. Okay? So you're saying to yourself, well, why is that significant? It's significant because that means that God already loved them, chose them, claimed them. God already loves you, has chosen you, claimed you. The law then is given as a gift, a way for them to fully experience the love and blessings that God has for them, because they are passing through different towns and peoples and cultures and people that have other religions and worshiping other gods, and they are being distracted and they're being influenced, and God's trying to help them understand, stay true to me, choose the one God, follow me. Now, in Deuteronomy, there's a thing called the Shema, and the Shema begins in Deuteronomy 4. It says, hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. That might sound familiar. Jesus said that to us. Keep these words that I'm commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Fix them as an emblem on your forehead and write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. The Reverend Cameron Howard says this: we make idols out of politicians or political ideologies. We chase after shiny new consumer goods. We spend hours of every day bowing toward our smartphones. Even within church, we may act as if church buildings or particular theological tenets or keeping the right people in or out is more important than the worship of God alone. When we choose God, when we choose life, it means that we start something, we begin in this discipline, this journey, this messy at times path, this holy relationship with God. And Moses is telling them, you have a significant choice to make, and it really bears upon everything you do. Because when you choose to follow God and follow these commandments, the commandments, and Jesus is going to get into this when we talk a little bit later today. It's fun stuff, the passages that are coming in a little while. We're going to talk about murder, idolatry, anger, divorce, talking bad about people, oaths, swearing. You know, all those things that other people do, not any of us. And so, but Jesus is trying to get us to understand that we have to move past just the moral tenets of the law. In other words, someone might say, well, I uphold the commandments. I'm a good person. I don't murder anybody. But yes, are you really showing love in terms of what you do? Are you showing kindness to your neighbor? Now, if any of you have had kids or maybe grandchildren, or maybe you've seen youth, I mean, what do we see when we're teaching young ones, right? You see it on the playground or at the birthday party or when they're going to school. What do we tell kids? Play nice. Behave. Share. What else do we tell them? Don't bite. What'd you say? Don't make me come back there. Yeah, right. Because they're probably, you know, hitting each other or wanting to. I mean, we teach kids all these nice things, don't we? Because why? We want them to grow up to be better than we are. And most of us here would want our children to go to church, right? To be believers in Jesus Christ. But yet, what are the priorities that we choose to do? Because if we're not showing them now, if we're not modeling for them now, if we're not teaching them now, why should we expect them to be great Christians later on? And so when we have this choice to choose life, it really means what are we doing now to invest in those that we are in community with and relationship with? Because we want kids to share. Yeah, you know, share your snacks. But as an adult, I'm not going to share that $20 with the food pantry. We want you to be nice out there on the playground, but on Facebook, I'm going to blast the bejesus out of somebody because of what they think or what they say or what they do. So we start to see maybe a disconnect, right, in terms of who we tell our kids to be, but then what are the choices that we're making? What are life-giving choices and life-draining choices? Life-giving choices about teaching, about covering. And so as parents, Tracy and I have a choice all the time. Because ourselves and other parents will go to great lengths to make sure that kids can get to sporting events or dance lessons or scouts or whatever the case may be, right? Run, 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 run. I left the house at 8:30 Saturday morning, didn't get home until 4:15 because I'm going from one thing to the other. And then I want my kid to be this great God-fearing Christian person. What am I doing to get them into church? And so maybe they miss church. What am I doing to get them into youth group or help out with one of the outreach projects that's put on by the youth ministry? And so, I'm critical of myself because Tracy and I have to have this conversation about how do we prioritize? What are we showing? What are we modeling? You know, so our kids, as they do stuff, you know, I'm wanting them to treat their friends with respect, or they now have members of the opposite sex in which they like, right? You know, it was a first time event yesterday. All three of us, my two boys and myself, had to go to the Hallmark store to buy Valentine's cards. It's just not my thing. So we did that. But you know, the point is, we're trying to make, right? We're trying to model behavior. We're trying to model what's important and priorities. And if we don't do it now, and we don't show that to our kids or to our young ones, to our youth, or help make as part of a community those resources available, it's just not going to magically happen later on. And God is saying to us, and Jesus follows the prophets that have come for centuries after him, are you choosing life? Are you choosing the way of blessing? Are you choosing to follow me and allow something to happen inside you so that you don't get distracted by the idols and the other things that this world would offer that become life draining? Those are just a few thoughts. And we're not even in the main message yet. We got the fun stuff coming. Let's say together a prayer of illumination. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock, my redeemer. Well, perhaps the best news of all today is that I took two pages of my message out. So I only brought three up. Yeah, all right, thanks, Tom. Well, at the first service, there was just so much, and so I'm going to change the approach, and we'll see what happens now, but I think we'll get through it. So, you know, I'm reading through, and, you know, this picking the right scripture today was really tough because I love that passage out of Deuteronomy, and Psalm was good, and the epistle text would have been really good to cover, but I really wanted us to work our way through the Sermon on the Mount. And so we're in the Gospel of Matthew. We're in chapter 5. We started with the Beatitudes, and now we're working on the Sermon on the Mount. And this text is, so somebody asked me this week, I want to start reading my Bible. Where should I start? Wow, that's a tough thing. And then they said, well, I want to read stuff about this. I'm like, well, you know, the Bible's, you know, it's just kind of, there's passages in there that can be difficult sometimes to understand. You got to understand the context and so forth. And this is one of those little areas, and we're going to read chapter 5, verses 21 through 37, because Jesus is teaching the disciples. And remember, he's brought them together. He goes through the Beatitudes, you know, blessed are you who are going to suffer a lot, and you're going to need it, and you're going to receive my peace. And then last week, we talked about the salt of the earth, the light of the world, that you're supposed to go out, that what you're hearing and reading and understanding is not just about you, but it's about going out into the world. And now we come into these series of passages, and there's really three sections that we're going to work through. And they're kind of difficult. And then the other thing that made it challenging this week was that, you know, sometimes they're a little bit of adult in nature, a little more mature themes. And I'm like, okay, this is X-Gen. There might be a number of kids in the crowd. And then I kept reading it, and I'm like, wow, that's like pointing a finger right at me. So's that verse. I'm not really sure I want to preach on this text. So Pastor Torito, you know, counseled me and said, you can't avoid it just because it's so indicting on you, you know. I said, all right, we'll go at it. But first of all, as we get in here, think about your image of God. We talked about this last week. What's your image of God? Because is God, again, some removed rule maker waiting to judge you, to punish you? Seeing if you're going to fail at upholding all the laws and commandments and the rules? Or do you see God as a loving parent, one who's walking with you, receiving you in grace and mercy? Because how we see God will also help us, you know, indicate how we're going to interpret these scripture passages. It's also going to indicate how we are in relationship with other people, not just in relationship with God, right? Your image of God. My image of God is one who is constantly with me, loving, presence, illuminating. The Holy Spirit, will convict me when I need to be convicted, to help guide me, to keep me in the path, keep me in the love and the will of Jesus Christ. Three things I want to cover, though. When we talk about the law or the commandments, you know, the Ten Commandments that come out of Exodus 18, you know, the Ten Commandments and the law that was given, the Torah that was given to the Israelites, that was given to them after God had claimed them, remember, right? And so the law is given as a gift. The law is given a gift to people, sort of an instruction on how to receive the fullness of life. And so we see this text today as a gift. We see also that the law was given to strengthen community, the community in which all people, by being together, can create and sustain relationships that nurture the health and safety of all people, regardless of race, color, where they come from, all of God's people. And we see that the law comes as a gift to strengthen the community by orienting us to the needs of our neighbor. So in other words, as we hear these, it's not just about how it impacts us, but as we follow the law, as we follow what Jesus is teaching us, as we follow the teachings of Jesus, because you know the law comes here and Jesus upholds the law, it automatically orients us outside of ourselves, outside of our sanctuary, to the needs of our neighbor. It puts us in relationship with us. Because it kind of comes back to what we talked about with the little kids, right? You need to share. You need to speak nice. Don't call names. All right. So let's pull out your Bibles if we have them, or we'll follow along. We're going to be in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, and we're going to talk with verse 21. And Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times," and so this is a kind of rabbinic approach where they cite the law or the rule. So the rabbi would say, "You've heard that this," and they would cite the law and the rule, and then they would explain, they would interpret it in the context of that contemporary time. "So you've heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment." Anger. So if you're angry, it's your life. What do we do with this anger? So what Jesus is going to do in all these situations is cite the law, the rule, but help move us past just its moral connotation to how are we living our life. So again, you've heard it said, "You shall not murder." Most of us are not going to go out and murder, right? But how many of us might be angry? How many of us might be angry at somebody? How many of you might be angry at one of the sisters sitting beside you, right? So we have three sisters sitting there in a row. So. We might get angry with a brother or sister. "And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hellfire." And so again, there's this, we see in this first section that we're dealing with issues of verbal abuse, how we treat people, that it's not okay just to say whatever. And we see within social media where people are verbally abusive with each other. All of a sudden, play nice, don't call them that name. How many of us start to fall into that trap on social media of saying to someone, "You're a horrible person," or "You do this," or "You do that"? So Jesus says in verse 23, "So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come offer your gift." So in other words, as you're worshiping me, as you're praising God, there's this challenge that if there's a part of your life, if there's a relationship in your life that is not right, that is not aligned with God, then you need to do something about it. that we work on this, that there's something that calling us, God's voice inside us, God's teaching, the Holy Spirit is saying, what do you need to do that moves towards forgiveness? What do you do that moves towards reconciliation? And then it says, verse 25, come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on your way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. And so I'm thinking about this, and how does that apply to us? So we have here where we're dealing with issues of anger. And again, Jesus got angry. So it's not that angry, being angry is a sin, but what does that anger cause us to do? Remember the story of Cain and Abel, Genesis 4? God says to Cain, why is your countenance fallen? Why are you angry? Watch, sin is lurking. And so the sin, the anger unexpressed, will manifest itself in some way, in an unhealthy way, hurting either the person who's angry or the object of the anger. That then becomes the sin. And so you see here what Jesus is trying to say is be aware of your relationships with each other. The anger, the verbal abuse, the words that you choose, because as disciples, you are to choose words that are in line with God's will and God's loving community that foster, nurture, sustaining relationships. Use good words. Speak words of truth. And then we get into where, you know, you say, you fool, you will be liable to the hellfire, you fool, and where we're calling people names. And again, when we call people names, we tell our children that's not okay. But we see it at all levels of social media today where it's okay to do that. And what we have to say as Christians is that it's not okay, that we don't have to follow that way, that we can choose to be different, that we can be the light of the world. Verse 27. You've heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And so here, Jesus is using hyperbole, he's using stark language to get our point across. In other words, don't let your desire cause you to sin. Change your way. Make a change in your life. Let your motivations be different. If you find yourself wanting to sin, what steps will you take to change that? And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. And so we have these references to hell here. And so hell, this references of hell and the hellfire really derive from a place in Gehenna where it was, not Gehenna, Ohio, but Gehenna. So outside of Gehenna, the dumps just burned constantly, okay? And they would offer human sacrifice to the god Moloch. And then this became a place where people would go to be punished and to suffer. And so that's where you get a lot of this, where they talk about the hell fire and so forth. And so again, what are you doing? Verse 31 in this section. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the grounds of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Jesus says a few things about divorce and adultery, and it's a little bit different in another gospel, and there's a ton of information that goes into this, more than we can cover today. But if we look at the point of what's happening here, what Jesus is getting at is, how are you in relationship with the one whom you love and whom you are married? Because back in antiquity, the woman was the property of the man. And so what are you doing that honors her? What are you doing that honors other people. And so as today we hear this, and I'm not saying no one should ever get divorced. I'm not saying that at all. What I'm saying is that when we come together as couples, as partners, and you're loving somebody, are you doing that in a way that God asks you to love that person? Do you see them as a gift from God? And in that relationship, is there equal power? Is there equal love? Are you respecting them? Because if we're doing everything that the Bible would ask us to do when in that relationship with each other, it would be a very life-giving relationship. Verse 33, and again, you've heard that it was said to those in ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for its footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And you do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. So we hear here where we're not supposed to swear, which again is indicting because I've said a swear word or two once or twice in my life. What? Chuckling. Yeah, I don't know. I'm working on it. So we hear, so what would happen here is that people would come together to take an oath. And so there was lots of rules surrounding by the oath. And what people were doing was, I'm going to swear this oath in this relationship with you, and I'm going to swear it by God. Or, you know, heaven's going to, I swear by heaven this will be done. Or they'd even started swearing by the Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem. And so people started, you know, swearing by all kinds of other things. And then the rabbis were saying, well, no, you don't need to do all that because what you're doing is now you're making heaven kind of like an idol. Or if you swear by your own self, now you're equating yourself as a god. Just as a believer, let your yes be yes and your no be no. You don't have to swear by all these other things. What happens is in our own human experience, we know that humans let each other down and say things they shouldn't and they do things they shouldn't. But as a community, working together, serving together, being out in the world together, can we choose words that are life-giving? Can we use words that choose to be as in the realm of God, the coming kingdom of God, where words of truth and life will be spoken? Can we use those words with each other so that our yes is yes and our no is no? Because we know then that we will follow through. We will be in good relationship with each other. So we hear all these things. And so again, I debated, you know, do we really want to cover all this? Because, you know, this isn't exactly always a feel-good message to be talking about. I mean, we're talking about murder, anger, divorce, adultery, all kinds of other things. But then I start to realize, isn't it part of our life and our world out there? And so to not deal with these a little bit is to ignore an important part of our human faith. This week I was talking with a parent who is struggling with some potential divorce issues, and in the devotion that they cover with their kids, it says in there, God says, well, ask whatever and you shall receive. And so the child's saying, well, I'm asking for God to make this divorce not happen. How come it's not? What do I tell my child? Those are moments where I wish God would really get on the ball, okay? Why am I defending God? And then I have to realize I'm not really defending God. And so we have this discussion, but you can see the challenge here, right? As we're growing in our faith, we often ask God, well, why aren't you doing this for me? You say ask, and it should happen. What are we teaching our children? And so we talked about some things. And the promise of God is always with us. And where Jesus says, you know, you will have problems in this world. And today's problems are enough, but I am with you always. At the end of Matthew, right? I am with you always, is what he says. And so we learn and find and try to find ways to experience God. But one of the things I said to them was this. Let your child see you struggle in your faith. Let your child see and hear the questions that you ask. Because otherwise, what happens is we sort of go through our problems and like, well, you got to believe in God, got to believe in God. And so the young one, the youth, never sees you asking tough questions or sees you dealing with that. Then when they inevitably have problems themselves or come to a crisis of faith, they're going to think they're messed up or wrong, or they've done something wrong, or that God has left them because, well, you know, my parents always had it right, or my grandma was, you know, she's had a strong faith. And you know, we all question, we all wonder. And so let them in on the questions you have of God and the wondering, because it's in that seeking, it's in that searching, it's in that listening that our faith builds and that we become mature Christians. Right? The other thing, I was talking with somebody, and we've covered this before. I said, tell me, you know, when you pray about this, tell me about your prayer. I pray this and that. And I'm like, well, then what? Well, I don't know, pray. And I'm like, what do you do? Well, I'll go get a cup of coffee or go get ready for work or whatever. You know, like, what are you getting at, pastor? Crazy guy asking questions. I said, well, did you listen? No. I said, oh, so you asked God a bunch of questions, then you just got up and went on, right? Like, God, you better do this for me and this for me. I want all this to happen, but I'm not even going to take time to sit around and listen to what you might have to say, right? These are the little things that as we are followers of Christ, as we take on this discipline, because what did Moses say? Choose life? Well, does that mean I choose life, I choose to follow God, and then everything's going to be miraculously great? No. It means that we choose, but we have a life of discipline. It's a life of practice. It's a life of daily choices that leads us in a development. So let's recap since January where we've come. Last week, we talked about being the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Was everybody a little bit salty this week? Did you let your light shine? In early January, we talked about the foundation of love. Then we talked about abiding in love. Then we talked about being our being, who we are in love. Last week, we talked about the generous gift giver, God. The generous gift giver, all good things come from God. The generous gift giver, in other words, we are salt, we are light. We have this gift that we've been given. And today, we talked about connectedness. So do you see now where we've come and where we're going? We're all going down this path together. There's purpose. And that if we are going to go out in the world and be in community, and work on these things, work, you know, trying to be in relationship with each other and understand our connectedness, we have to start out with a foundation in love. And that we can't just learn these theological tenets without being able to put them into practice with each other, which also means forgiveness with each other, giving each other some space and some grace and some mercy. Reverend Lewis says this, that being a disciple of Jesus is not a solitary affair, but can and should happen within a community of the faithful. There is no way that what they, the disciples, do, what Jesus will ask them to do, what Jesus asks us to do, can reach its full potential without the realization of the companionship and the community of the faithful with you and beside you. Once you realize this, your potential as a disciple, who you can be as a disciple, is not just dependent upon you, but is helped by another. This is then when we realize the scope of the connectedness within the gospel. And this could be tough to hear because our world favors and rewards individualism, autonomy, independence. In Matthew, we just celebrated at Christmas time and at Advent the birth of Jesus Christ. What do the angels say his name should be. Emmanuel, God with us. So it's more than just God with you, God with me. It's God with us, our relationship to each other, our willingness to serve, to help out, to be part, to be vulnerable, to serve, to share, to give, to love, to forgive. To realize if we're becoming angry, to realize if we're being motivated by a wrong desire, and then go to the Lord where we can choose life. Amen. Will our deacons come forward and collect today's tithes and offerings? As you guys are collecting today's tithes and offering, I just want to share a little story. This week, we met with all the principals of all the schools in Canal Winchester and Human Services, and we came together because some parents in the community said, there are kids in our schools who are not being fed. There's kids in our schools who are hungry, and it's more than just elementary schools. It's in the middle schools. It's in the high schools. And this problem becomes even worse in the summertime. So what can we do to come together as a community to help them? Well, we're doing a couple things. One, we've just started a reading program, after-school reading program and mentor program. We had one person when this morning started. We're now up to three people that will come in and help during the week. And we're going to start that here. And we want that to expand past the daycare that operates here in the church and includes the rest of the community. So when we talk about sharing and want kids to play nice, again, what are we doing now to model that behavior? And so if you're retired or you've got time in the afternoons, I want you to seriously consider and pray, well, are you willing to come here an hour, once a week, several times a week, whatever you want, and to work with a young person, to give them attention, to allow them to read to you, to help them with 4 plus 4. So those are the things that we can do. Are we willing to do them, to put them into practice? We've received a lot from God. In Proverbs 19, verse 17, it says, be kind to the poor, and the Lord will repay you. Be kind to the poor. Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord and will be repaid in full. That's the exact words. To be kind to the poor, you lend to the Lord and you're repaid in full. How will you choose to be repaid by God?
Welcome back. You may have a question from today's message or something that you've read in the Bible. I encourage you to contact me here at the church because I'd love to meet with you or talk with you and support you on your faith journey.